Ephesians chapter 6, if you're taking notes, the title of the message is Dressed for Defense. Dressed for Defense. How many knows that when you go outside in the winter, you get dressed for the occasion? Amen? You don't go out there in a pair of boxer shorts and a sleeveless t-shirt and without your shoes and socks and run around. That'd be just absolutely crazy of a notion that somebody would do that. No, you get your gloves on, you have your winter coat on, you have your hat on, you have sometimes if it's snowing really deep outside, you have your boots on or galoshes over your shoes. You get prepared for it. You get prepared for it. You're dressed for the occasion. Just like in battle, a soldier dresses for the occasion. He just doesn't go out there in a fluorescent orange shirt with a red bandana on his head, strolling down in shorts and tennis shoes out on the battlefield. No, if you did that, guess what would happen? You'd get shot. You're just like a big red bullseye or orange bullseye, you know, with a red bullseye on your head. No, you get dressed for battle. You're in all your battle garments. You're in your BDUs. You're in your battle dress uniform that's camouflaged. You have a helmet on. You have your boots on, combat boots on. You have your flak jacket and your LBE, light battle equipment with your belt on. You have your M16. You have even an Alice pack sometimes that carries your pup tent and everything else, and different supplies in it. You're fully dressed to the hilt to go to battle. The flak jacket and stuff to protect you. And so we're going to talk about being dressed for defense. So in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, we're reading from verse 10 to 18. It says, "Now finally, my brother, beloved ones, be supernaturally infused with the strength through your life union with the Lord Jesus. Stand victorious and with the forces of his explosive power flowing in and through you. Put on the full suit of armor." Excuse me here. That God wears when you go into battle, so that when you that you will be protected as you fight against the evil strategies of the accuser. Your hand-to-hand combat is not with human beings, but it is the highest. It is the highest principalities and authorities operating in rebellion under the heavenly realms, for they are a powerful class of demons and evil spirits that hold this dark world in bondage. Because of this, you must wear all the armor that God provides, so you're protected as you confront the slanderer. For you are destined for all things and will rise victorious. Put on the belt of truth to strengthen you to stand in triumph. Put on holiness as the protective armor that covers your heart. Stand on the feet alert, and you'll always be ready to share your blessings of peace as you subdue your enemies. In every battle, take faith as your wrap around shield, for it is able to extinguish the blazing arrows coming at you from the evil one. Embrace the power of salvation's full deliverance. Like a helmet protects your thoughts from lies, and take the mighty spirit sword of the spoken word of God. Pray passionately in the spirit as you consistently intercede with every form of prayer at all times. Pray the blessings of God upon all his believers. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. Lord God, may your word, Lord God, come alive, Lord God, to us in such a way that causes us to be changed and transformed more into your likeness and your image, getting rid of the carnal, fleshly, natural man. Lord God, may we be infused with the of the almighty word of God this morning, that we may take it and use it and walk it out in our everyday Christian life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. So it says right here, in verse 10, it says, the stand. It says the stand, doesn't it? Stand victoriously. What does it mean to be, this is a stand? What must we do to take a stand and take a firm position against the enemy and advance the kingdom of God everywhere we go and everywhere we are? See, everywhere you are and everywhere, not only everywhere you go, but everywhere you are, you're in a battle. You're in a battle against principalities, against powers, against the forces of evil, the forces of darkness. You battle at home, you battle it when you go out of your house, you battle it in church sometimes with your thought life. Say, what are you talking about, Pastor? You battle, and when you're trying to listen to the word of God that's being spoke, and even worship, what are we going to have to eat? I don't know what we're going to have to eat today. What am I going to prepare? Those thoughts come into your life, and you get distracted from what God wants to do in your life. That's why you got to be dressed for defense. That's why you can pull down these arguments, say, no, I'm not going to think about that, because I'm in the middle of praise and worship. I'm in the middle of receiving an answer from God. I'm in the middle of, right now, receiving the engrafted word of God. A fresh revelation. So you must take every thought captive. So in order to stand, you and I must first grasp a firm understanding of what the meaning of the word stand is, and right? If you don't know what it is to stand, what good is it just to read something and say, hey, you got to take a stand. Hey, what does that mean to take a stand? I don't know. We're going to find out. Mr. Webster says this. It means to have or maintain an upright position, a firm attitude or belief toward a particular issue. And the Thayer's Word Book of the New Testament, this is what the Greek means to stand. It means to cause or make a stand to place, make a firm fix or established place. Uphold or sustain the authority or force of anything, to continue safe and sound, to stand unharmed, to stand, to be ready or prepared, to be steadfast in your mind, of quality, of one who does not hesitate, does not waver, to be in a fixed position on solid ground. That's what it means to take a stand, or to stand. And in order to stand, you must have a firm foundation on the solid rock, Christ Jesus. Solid rock, Christ Jesus. It says in verse 10, be supernaturally infused with strength through your life union with the Lord Jesus. Stand victorious with the forces of his explosive power flowing in through you. Beloved, it is a strength flowing into you like waterfalls, as we've been seeing throughout the theme throughout Ephesians. Flowing in you like waterfalls and then flowing through you like a raging river, changing everything it comes in contact with. And there's that expression again. It is his strength flowing through you like waterfalls, and then flowing in you like waterfalls, and then flowing through you like a raging river, changing everything it comes in contact with. It's not a destructive path. It's a constructive path that it brings forth through you. And like I said, in order to stand, you must have a firm foundation on the solid ground. That is Christ Jesus. In Matthew 16:13-18, it says in verse 13, when Jesus and his disciples were near the town of Caesarea Philippi, he asked them, "What do people say that about me?" And the disciples answered, "Some say that you're John the Baptist, or maybe Elijah, or Jeremiah, or other prophets." Then Jesus asked them. See, he could ask them everybody what everybody else says. Then he said, asked them, "Who do you say I am?" And that's the same question he's asking us today. Who do you say that I am? And so then Simon Peter spoke up and, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Verse 16. Jesus said, told Simon, him, "Simon, son of Jonah, you were blessed. You didn't discover this on your own. It was shown to you by my Father in heaven." And in verse 18, "So I call you Peter." Could you imagine that? Say, "You're Peter." That's such a revelation, isn't it? It'd be like, "Hey, you're Rose, or you're Tony, or you're Joe," whatever, you know? "Wow, that's such a revelation, God. My name is this." "Well, wait a minute. That's the name my mother and father gave me at birth." That's interesting. It says, "You are Peter." It means you're the rock. Peter means, Petros means rock. It says, on this rock, not on him, not on Peter, but on this rock, this the revelation that Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Christ, the Lord, the Savior of mankind. He says, upon that revelation of me, Jesus, I am the rock. I will build my church, and the death and death itself will not have any power over it. Firm foundation on the solid rock, Christ Jesus. He said the gates of hell will not prevail against, will not be able to defeat it. Not on Peter or anything of secession of the papacy. I hate to say that. In fact, guess what? Peter wasn't, basically, it doesn't say anything about him being in Rome. Paul was. I was at the place in Jerusalem that was supposed to be the grave of Peter. How about that? And his bones were supposed to be in the Vatican. Now, I'm not coming against anybody in the faith, but the thing is, you know what? Religion is that, just religion. But what I'm talking about here is the rock, Christ Jesus, and you got to have your firm foundation, your feet upon the firm foundation of the solid rock. In fact, this is what God told me. He said, "It's my love that causes you to remain in me, and it's intimacy that causes you to be stayed in my love." Let me say that again. He said, "It's my love that causes you to remain in me, and it's intimacy that causes you to be stayed in my love." Now that we have just a little bit, glimpse of what it means to stand, let's take a look at standing firm in the faith of God and what Paul is saying here in these verses. Number one, verse 11, if you're taking notes, notice here whose armor that we are to clothe ourselves with. It's God's armor, right? It's God's armor. In other words, he is the one that protects us. He is the one that gives us the means by which we are safe from the onslaught of the enemy. It's not our own man-made devices or schemes that do the job. Beloved, there are people that think they can defeat evil by natural and ordinary means, but to no avail. How many hasn't seen the Ghostbuster, the old one and the new one? You can't use some kind of nuclear device to catch devils because that does not work. They're supernatural spirit beings. These things are supernatural. In fact, the Bible declares in 2 Corinthians the only means by which evil forces are defeated. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 to 5, says, verse 3 says, "For we walk in the flesh as mortal men. We are not carrying on the spiritual warfare according to the flesh by using the weapons of man. The weapons of our warfare are not physical weapons of flesh and blood. Our weapons are divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying sophisticated arguments and every exalted and proud thing that sets itself up against the true knowledge of God, and we take every thought and purpose captive to the obedience of Christ." It says here that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Carnal, fleshly, man-made weapons are not strong enough. It's like going into battle with a toy gun. It goes, makes all the noises and flashing lights, but it does not fire anything. And also, in verse 2, verse 12, this is number 2, verse 12, we see that our fight is not against flesh and blood, but against supernatural beings that rebelled against the truth and were cast out from heaven along with Satan, and they are out to bring as many into bondage against the truth as they can. They're working hard. Hard. And there's no days off for them. They try harder each and every day, trying to get in and scheme away and lie against the truth in your lives. Especially if you're in ministry or have a ministry or have been an example of to people in different areas. If you've been married for a long time, they trying to get in because you're an example to people who are married, just young people that are married, and they want to know. They look to you for an example. The enemy hates that because there's a union. They'll try to get in the way. And not only that, any area of your life, they try to get in your way. Why? Because they cannot be saved. They got cast out. They are on a grudge, a retribution mission. They can't get it over with God, so they try to get it over with God's children. And there are two things in this verse that speaks to us. First, it reminds us the battle is not against other humans. We do not struggle against flesh and blood. Sometimes we focus on people like abortionists, pornographers, godless politicians, corrupt business leaders, drug dealers, purveyors of the people that's just out there flaunting their filth, and other peoples that we may have problems with as if they are the source of a problem. Yet those people are unwitting being used by the powers of the spiritual forces that they know nothing about, or just unaware that they are playing playing as a puppet in their life. Some of them are morally culpable for the choices. Everybody is. They are morally culpable for their choices that they make. But they may also be manipulated by evil beings that influence them in ways that they do not realize. And let me put this, everybody can be used in the way, if we're not careful, by the enemy's lies that they whisper into your ears. getting you enraged in a way that you shouldn't be. Or we can make it more personal about that. When someone has hurt us deeply, it's easy to say that person is a source of all my problems. Let me say that again. If somebody has hurt us or done something to us, it is easy to say that the person is the source of all my problems. But our struggle is not with what? Flesh and blood. Even though it may seem that way most of the time. So attack the problem, not the people. Find out what the source of the problem is. The source of the problem, if it bring contention and strife, and guess what's in the middle of that? All sorts of demons, the book of James says. The second part of this verse that speaks significant is that this verse teaches us that there are various types of demonic powers. All those phrases are roughly equivalent in that they all refer to spiritual powers arrayed against us. They teach us that there are various kinds of demonic powers. There are rulers, authorities, powers of darkness of the world, spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Now, it's not clear, the Bible doesn't say or clarify how we should differentiate between them. But the thing is, there are different classifications. Perhaps it's enough to know that they're just various types of angels. There are different types of angels, so the demons are organized and serve different purposes in Satan's service. The word rulers doesn't refer to mayors or governors or presidents. It's not about Obama or Osama or Bush or Putin. It's about people you work with or your boss on a bad day or anyone else who gets under your skin. On those days when people treat you badly, you may feel like they are the enemy, but they're not. Not in the deepest sense at all. It's the enemy. Also says in the Bible that there are different classes of demons, the angels, fallen angels, that follow in the ranks of Satan. It's just enough to say that there are forces at work that don't like you, and they're going to try to manipulate you to believe in a lie all that they can. Number 3 in verse 13. Therefore, put on the full, complete armor of God so that you will be able successfully resist and stand at your ground in the evil day of danger. And having done everything that the crisis demands, to stand firm in your place, fully prepared, immovable, and victorious. Therefore, take up the complete armor. Paul introduces the idea of the complete armor of God here and back in verse 11. Excuse me. Here Paul declared the details, some specific things related to the armor of God. In this verse, he simply states what the main purpose of the spiritual warfare and armor of God is. That you may be able to stand without the strength of God, beloved, and the protection of spiritual armor, it is impossible to stand against the attacks of spiritual enemies. Let me say that again. Without the strength of God and protection of these things that God has equipped us with, the spiritual armor of God, we're not able to stand. He says that you may be able to stand. Hallelujah. That you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, this describes the purpose for the strength of God and the armor of God that we are to use them for. Not only that he gives us purpose, right here, that you may be able to withstand. We're not able to stand without the strength of God and the purpose, and having all that the purpose describes, the strength of God and armor that we use for them, but that we're able to use them when the enemy attacks. That's every day. 24/7. There's no let off. Sometimes they'll attack you in your dreams. That's what you got to know, that you know that you know, and have that firm foundation in Christ Jesus in your heart and your life. See, God has given his people a call, mission, a destiny to fulfill. Satan will do his best to stop it. When he attacks and intimidates, we are to stand. We do the Lord's work and stand against every hint of spiritual opposition. He says to stand in his power, in his might. God gives Christians a glorious standing to maintain by faith in spiritual warfare. We are to stand in grace, beloved. Romans 5:2, through him we also have access by faith in this grace by which we stand and rejoice in the hope of God's glory. Not only we stand in grace, we stand in the gospel. 1 Corinthians 15:1, and brothers, I declare to you the gospel which I preach to you, which also you have received and in which you stand. We also stand in faith. 2 Corinthians 1:24, not that we have dominion over you, your faith, but we are your helpers of your joy, for by faith you stand. We also stand in Christian liberty. Galatians 5:1, we have freedom now because Christ made us free, so stand strong in that freedom or liberty. Don't go back into slavery again. And we stand also, we stand in Christian unity. Philippians 1:27, only let your conduct becomes the gospel of Christ. So whether I come to you and see you or else am absent, I hear of your affairs that you stand fast in one spirit. Stand fast, striving together with one mind for the faith of the gospel. Or in other words, stand fast in unity. And we stand fast also in the Lord. Philippians 4:1, therefore, my brothers, once loved and longed for, my joy and crown, stand fast in the Lord, beloved ones. Stand fast in the Lord. Hallelujah. See, all in all, there's a lot indicated by that one word, stand. It means that we're going to be attacked. It means that we must not be frightened or afraid. It means that we must not droop or slouch or nor be uncertain or half-hearted in the fight. No self-pity, pity party. It means also that we are at our position and alert. It means that we do not give in even a thought to retreat. There's no sound of retreat in God's army. So that's what the word stand. There's a lot of stuff in the word stand. And verses 14 through 17, if you're taking notes, I guess this is number 4. Paul goes into detail of what the army of God consists of. First thing in verse 14, he talks about the belt of truth, right? Having tightened the wide band of truth, personal integrity, moral courage around your waist. See, soldiers in Paul's day wore belts to secure their clothing and hold weapons. The belt of truth has similar, but explained functions for spiritual warfare that include sanctification, The belt of truth sets us apart from people who don't follow God. Jesus prayed that God would sanctify us by truth, the word. In John 17, 17, he said, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. To sanctify means to set apart for a special purpose and to purify. The truth helps us to stay on mission for God and avoid falling back into sin's corruption. Guidance. The Holy Spirit uses truth to guide us in whatever circumstances we're in. John wrote, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come in John 16, 13. Just as communication is very vital to the physical battlefield, so is the Holy Spirit's guidance via the truth on the spiritual battlefield. We need the Holy Spirit's guidance through the Word in the spiritual battle that we're in. Not only that, but intelligence and discernment. How many knows that discernment is very, very crucial and vital? Just like intelligence is, the intelligence is to the natural battlefield. Intelligence data and its interpretation, discernment, can play a critical role in the outcome of military conflicts. God's word reveals truth and helps us decisively recognize the devil's lies in spiritual conflicts. Hebrews 4:12 explains how the word reveals truth. For the word of God is a living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even the dividing of soul and spirit, joint and marrow. It judges the thoughts of the attitudes of heart, armed with the truth of the word. We'll recognize, beloved, the devil's lies and what they are. Not only that, we'll be ready for the battle, battle readiness. See, belts were used in the Bible times to secure loose garments so that the person could run or fight effectively. The belts also provided a place to attach the weapon, their sword. When the enemy attacks us, beloved, we may have to move quickly and use our spiritual weapons of praise, prayer, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and on the run. The belt of truth enables us to move quickly and confidently without tripping into lies and losing our weapons by believing in the lie. The belt of truth. And beloved, to give some background here, Paul is talking about the spiritual armor because he was a Roman citizen. And how he got his Roman citizenship is because his dad and him lived near the town of Tarsus, which was a military town, had a military base. And what they did, they made tents for the military. They had a government contract to make tents for the army. So they would spend time on the army bases and get the, and Paul got to know the inside and out of what it was to be a Roman soldier. So he begins to speak about the Roman soldier, and here he talks about the Roman soldier and the armor that they wore. Not only the belt of truth, but in verse 14, the breastplate of righteousness. Now, what does a breastplate protect? Your heart, one of the most vital organs. It says, put on the breastplate of righteousness, an upright heart. The imagery is of an armed Roman soldier prepared for battle. A typical armed soldier wore a breastplate made of bronze or chain mail. It covered the vital organs, namely the heart, and was fitted with loops and buckles that attached it to the thick belt. If the belt was loose, the breastplate slipped right off. That's the thing, the belt is the centerpiece of all the armor. Without it, all the other pieces fall off. That's why the Word of God has got to be the center place in your life. Without it, your life just falls apart. When Paul compares the armor of God with military gear, each piece represents a part of God's strength that he extends to us when we become his children. The breastplate of righteousness refers to the righteousness purchased by Jesus at the cross. At salvation, a breastplate is issued or given. In that essence that Paul is referring here to, a repentant heart. It is specifically designed by God to protect our heart and soul from evil and deception. See, beloved, our own righteous acts are no match for Satan's attacks. The breastplate of righteousness has Christ's name stamped right on it. As though he said, your righteousness isn't sufficient to protect you, wear mine. Martin Luther, how many knows who Martin Luther is? Wrote about it when he posted this thesis on the doors of the Wittenberg Church. He said, solo Christo, in Christ alone. It's by his righteousness that he gives to us upon salvation that makes us right standing with God. So in essence, God, because of Jesus, exchanges our filthy rags for has never done anything wrong in our life before. When we fully understand this revelation of righteousness, it then will protect our hearts, our emotions, from being swayed from the truth and committing acts that are contrary to his word, sin. Because of what Christ has done for us and to us on the cross, we are too good to sin. So we need to stop and allow the revelation of righteousness of Christ to have its perfect work in us so that we would consistently walk in right standing with the truth. Let me say that again. Because of what Christ has done for us and to us on the cross, we are too good to sin. So we need to stop and allow the revelation of the righteousness of Christ to have its perfect work in us so that we would consistently walk in right standing with the truth, the Word of God. Not only the breastplate of righteousness and the belt of truth, but verse 15 says, shoes shod with the gospel of peace, and having strapped on your feet the gospel of peace in preparation to face the enemy with a firm-footed stability and ready produced by the good news. Now Matthew Henry had this to say about the shoes of the gospel of peace. In his commentary, he said, the preparation of the gospel of peace signifies a prepared and resolved frame of heart to adhere to the gospel and abide by it, which will enable us to walk with a steady pace in the way of religion, notwithstanding the difficulties and dangers that may be in it. It is styled the gospel of peace because it brings all sorts of peace. Peace of God with ourselves and with others. And may also meant of which prepares for the entertainment of the gospel, naming repentance. With this, our feet must be shod for the living a life of repentance. We are armed against temptation and sin and the designs of the great enemy. He goes on to say that Dr. Whibley thinks this may be the sense of the word, and Dr. Whibley is a theologian, that you may be ready for the combat, be shod with the gospel of peace. Endeavor after the peaceable and quiet mind which the gospel calls for. Be not easy provoked, nor prone to quarrel, but show all gentleness and all long suffering to all men and women. And this will certainly preserve you from any great temptations and persecutions, as did those the shoes of brass, the soldiers from whose foot's traps. Put on the gospel of the shoes of peace. The gospel is all about peace. What is the gospel about? It is about the Prince of Peace. And when you have these shoes, it's not a physical shoe that you put on, but it's you accept from God the peace of God, which is like you walking every day at peace with not only God, but yourself, but with other people as well. And when you have these shoes on, you won't be so apt to kick and kill people that are wounded and need help, namely other Christians. It is said that Christians are the only ones that kick their wounded. But if you have the shoes of the gospel of peace on in your heart, you'll live as the Prince of Peace and want to reach out a helping hand and begin to extend healing to them. Not only the shoes of the gospel of peace, but the shield of faith. Turn to somebody and say, shield of faith. In verse 16, it talks about the shield of faith. Above all, lift up the protective shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Beloved, these shields back then were made of thick layers of leather. Yeah, that's old, folks. Leather that were saturated with oil and was rubbed into the leather so they would not crack or weaken. They would also douse the shield with water so that when the flaming arrows of the enemy came, the water would put out the fire. See, the enemies back then would shoot arrows dipped in pitch and tar, and they would light it on fire, and it would hurl them at the enemy. So anything that they were barricaded behind, like it was wood or something, it would burn up. Then they shoot regular arrows at them. So they would have these shields, big shields made out of leather that were doused, rubbed it with oil, so it would be pliable, and it would be tough, and it would be the cracks, it wouldn't crack. So when the swords would come and just hit it, or the battle axes would just hit it and not break through the brittle leather because it did not have no oil. And it was doused with water. These things were heavy. Can you imagine a shield doused? They were like 70, 80, 90 pounds at times, these shields. And they weren't small. They come up to about a man's waist or a little bit higher, and round enough so that it would cover their whole body. Beloved, we too need to be saturated by oil, which symbolizes Holy Spirit, and the water, which represents the Word of God. When we are filled to overflowing with Holy Spirit and the Word, nothing from the enemy will be able to touch us. Let me say that again. When we are filled to overflowing with the Holy Spirit and the Word of God, nothing from the enemy will be able to touch us. Not only the shield of faith, but the helmet of salvation. In verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation. What does the helmet protect? See, all kinds of helmets. You have football helmets, you have bicycle helmets, motorcycle helmets, you have combat helmets. What does the helmet protect? It protects your noggin, doesn't it? Your brain. You don't have your brain, guess what? You die. That's what the book of Ecclesiastes says, right? It says when the golden bowl is cracked, guess what? Your body goes to the ground and your soul goes to heaven. That's what it says. the golden bowl. This gets cracked. Guess what? You're done. Of course, there's miracle, but or there's a zipper, and you stuff stuff in it. The helmet protects the head. Some of the helmets were made of thick leather covered with metal plates, and others were heavy molded or beaten metal. They usually had cheek pieces to protect the face. The purpose of the helmet, of course, was to protect the head from injury, particularly from the dangerous broadsword commonly used in the warfare of that day. It was a large, two-handed, double-edged sword that measured 3 or 4 feet in length. It was often carried by cavalrymen who would swing at the heads of the enemy soldiers to split their skulls or decapitate them. That's what they were intended to do. The fact that the helmet is related to salvation indicates that Satan's blows are directed at the believer's security insurance in Christ. The two dangerous edges of Satan's spiritual broadsword are discouragement and doubt. To discourage us, he points to our failures, our sins, and unresolved problems, our poor health, or whatever else seems negative in our lives in order to make us lose confidence in the love and care of our Heavenly Father. It's all directed at our minds. We gotta have the helmet of salvation. We gotta be renewed in the Word. Cast down every argument and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. As we read earlier in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 through 5. Not only the helmet of salvation, but it talks about in verse 17, the sword of the Spirit, which is what? The Word of God. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The sword is both an offensive and defensive weapon that was used by the soldiers. In this case, it is a weapon belonging to the Holy. It is a weapon belonging to the Holy Spirit. Swords were used to protect oneself from harm or the attack of the enemy, to overcome and or kill him. Defense, blocking every blow that comes against you. Swords were used to protect oneself from harm or attack of the enemy. Training on the proper use of the swords to get maximum protection. See, they trained a lot. How to block. And that's what the Word of God does. That's what Jesus done out in the desert, didn't he? He used the Word of God to block every attempt of the enemy to get in. We know that from 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, that the Word of God is from the Holy Spirit and written by a man, since every Christian is on the spiritual battle with the satanic and evil forces of this world, we need to know how to handle the Word properly. We need to know how to handle it properly. And we need to know it. We need to allow the God to be overflowing with the Word of God, which we have received the fullness of the Word of God and grafted inside of us at the moment we received Him as Lord and Savior. Demolishing strongholds. God refers to His Word as a sword in Hebrews 4:12. Here the Word is described as living and active and sharper than any double-edged sword. The Roman sword was commonly made in this manner. The fact that it had two edges made it easier to penetrate, as well as to cut in every way. The idea is that of piercing or penetrating. The word of God reaches the heart, the very center of actions, and lays open the motives and feelings of those it touches. The purpose of the sword of the Spirit, the Bible, is to make us strong and able to withstand the evil onslaught of our enemy, Satan. The Holy Spirit uses the power of the Word to save souls and to give them spiritual strength and maturity in the Lord in fighting this corrupt and evil that we're talking about. The more we know and understand the Word of God, the more useful we will be in doing the will of God, and the more effective we will be in standing against the enemy of our souls. And it also talks, finally come running around home, in verse 18, prayer. It says, pray passionately in the Spirit as you consistently intercede with every form of prayer at all times. Pray the blessings of God upon all the believers. It talks about fellowship prayer, supplication, and intercession. Beloved, fellowship prayer is intimate discussion pertaining to your love or relationship with Jesus. You and I communicating with Him how much we love Him and giving Him thanks and allowing Him to return His love by pouring into you and I and speaking to us relationally as a loving father to a son or daughter. That's the type of relationship I'm talking about here, speaking His love into us. One of the most intimate ways you and I could speak to Him is in the Spirit. And part of that is praying in tongues. Why? I believe because of what Jude says in verse 20. But you, beloved, build yourselves up the foundation of the most holy faith. Continually progress, rise like the edifice higher and higher. Pray in the Holy Spirit. Why? Because it edifies you, it builds you up. The second thing it talks about supplication in verse 18. Supplication is commonly defined as the action of asking or begging for something earnestly or humbly. The word supplication comes from the Latin term supplicare, which means to plead humbly and has the word supple as its root. When we pray with supplication, we are not only humbly submitting our request to God, we're doing it in the mindset of allowing our minds to be supple and receptive to God's will. We want God to mold our thinking, our opinions, and our emotions to be in line with His thinking, opinions, and emotions. When this happens, beloved, God changes us to be more like His Son, which changes our desires and our wills to be in line with His. And finally, beloved, it talks about intercession in verse 18. All kinds of prayers. Intercession is prayer that goes beyond just asking God for things for either yourself or somebody else. It is prayer that stands in the gap for someone. It is praying on behalf of someone. It is when you and I stand beside God Himself and hear the heart of God and then declare into the atmosphere surrounding situations that people are going through and the dynamics of their situations change to reflect an outcome that brings glory to the Lord. That's a long definition, isn't it? That's what basically intercession is. when you and I stand beside God at the throne room and begin to hear the heart of God about situations that people are going through, or nations or anything that's going through, then you hear the heartbeat of God, then you declare what you hear God speaking of, because it's His heartbeat and it's His will for the situation, and you speak in the atmosphere surrounding the person or people or nations or whatever you're praying for. You're declaring on God's side, and you'll see things begin to change in people's nations and whatever situation's life that you're praying for. So, beloved, that's the armor of God. That's Galatians chapter 6 in a nutshell. So stay underneath the waterfall of God's grace and mercy as we close out this series on the book of Ephesians. It's just so wonderful, the book of, stay underneath the waterfalls of His grace and love and mercy. Beloved, as that one commercial says, and it's not about beer, I'm talking about the Holy Spirit, I'm talking about the Word of God. Stay thirsty, my friends, for the Word of God, for the Holy Spirit, for the things of God. And stay underneath the waterfalls and get doused to saturated, completely filled up to overflowing measures. And when you're filled up underneath the waterfalls of His love, let the raging river of God just flow through you, changing everything in its path. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day, for Your Word. Apply Your Word to our lives. Lord God, may we stay thirsty. Even more hungry than we ever before, Lord. In Jesus' name, for You, for Your Word, for Your Holy Spirit. May we stay underneath the waterfalls of Your love to be filled to overflowing, that Your raging rivers may flow out of us. As Your Word said, rivers of living water shall flow out of You, and it will change everything in our path. In Jesus' name. Now, Lord Jesus, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift His countenance upon you and grant you His peace. Shalom. Nothing broken, nothing lacking. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And everyone said, amen and amen. Everyone be blessed.